Did you know what's going to happen to you when you complete reading the Shrimad Bhagavatam, or even when you are starting, or when you are in the process, you have completed some chapters, or you're just getting a gist of it? All right, so if you do not know what's going to happen, then stay tuned. This video is for you. All right, so if you're new, then please subscribe, and if you want a reading, then go to my website below. And we will start again with the Shrimad Bhagavatam. I stopped this series in June because I was very busy with certain activities, and now here it is. So please watch the other videos in this playlist, okay, or else you may not understand what I am speaking. And there you go, God is there with you all the time. Just look to him and you will find him. So we are still in the first canto, first chapter, first verse. All right, it's 1.1.1. the purport is still not over. And hopefully in this video, we will complete this purport. Okay, the purport is very big. And yes, before we go to the purport, we should always recite the verse of the Shrimad Bhagavatam once at least. Okay, ideally we should do it thrice, but due to the interest of time, I do it only once here. All right. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya Janmadyasya Yatonvaya Ditaratascharteshu Bhigyaswarat Tene Brahma Hridayadi Kavaye Mohyanti Yata Suraya Tejo Varimridam Yathavini Mayostri Sargo Mrisha Namana Swena Nirasta Kuhakam Satyam Paramadhimahi. So we discussed that what is Lord Krishna's importance, what is the Shrimad Bhagavatam, and how the living entity, that is people like you, me, cats, dogs, animals, how they are different from God, all right? And now, at the end, we will see how the Shrimad Bhagavatam helps us, okay? What's the end goal? What's the end result? All right, so we stopped at that statement. Atheists like Ravana or Hiranyakashipu had to undergo severe penances before they could flout the authority of the Lord. But ultimately, they were rendered helpless and could not save themselves when the Lord appeared before them as cruel death. So Ravana was killed by Lord Ram, and Hiranyakashipu was killed by Lord Narsingdev himself. They are all avatars of Lord Vishnu, as we all know. This is also the case with the modern atheists who dare to flout the authority of the Lord. Such atheists will be dealt with similarly, for history repeats itself. So here it said that there are many atheists and there are many people these days who will say, oh, you know, God doesn't exist. That same thing was being told by Ravan in Treta Yuga and Hiranyakashipu in the Satya Yuga. So during these two yugas also, there were these great personalities, great personalities, you know, like Ravan, who used to kidnap the wives of other people. Yes, he was so great. And Hiranyakashipu also, who used to loot the public like anything. And even today, there are so many people who says, oh, you are just wasting time reading these boring old books. You know, these things will not help you actually. So suppose you go to your company and you tell somebody you are chanting some mantra or anything like this, or you are going to some holy place like Tirupati or Haridwar, suppose, then they will make fun of you, they will mock you. This all happens all the time. Or if you say you are a vegetarian, then also they will try to insult you. They will, because that's how this material world is designed. There will be atheists in every yuga. But the problem is, in Kali Yuga, the number is too much, all right? So such atheists will be dealt with similarly, for history repeats itself. Whenever men neglect the authority of the Lord, nature and her laws are there to penalize him. This is confirmed in Bhagavad Gita, in the well-known verse, Yada yada hi dharmasya glanir bhavati bharata abhyuthanam adharmasya tadatmanam srijamyaham. Whenever there is a decline of dharma and a rise of adharma, O Arjuna, then I incarnate myself. Bhagavad Gita, 4th chapter, 7th verse, 4.7. So basically, there are people who say these days that you can do whatever you want, like you can kill animals, you can eat them, it's fine. So then what happens is karma backfires. So they will also experience terrible suffering in some area of their life. Now you may not know when that will happen or how that is happening, but eventually one day in this life or in some other life, they will experience this, all right? Or if they are into intoxication or gambling or illicit sex, then also this happens. Then Lord will descend, and every yuga he will take some avatar and he will teach a lesson to these people. That the Supreme Lord is all perfect is confirmed in all Shruti mantras. It is said in the Shruti mantras that the all perfect Lord threw a glance over matter and thus created all living beings. Now Shrutis refer to those scriptures which are directly heard, alright, from God himself said, and that's what is a Shruti, alright. And then there is something called a Smriti also, about which we'll discuss later. So it said that he threw a glance over matter and thus created all living beings. So unless Lord Vishnu will put his glance over the material nature, it doesn't work. Everything stays static. But when he sees, everything gets dynamic. You start moving, I start speaking, everything starts happening. So that is happening by his glance. His glance is very powerful. The living beings are parts and parcels of the Lord, and he impregnates the vast material creation with seeds of spiritual sparks. And thus the creative energies are set in motion to enact so many wonderful creations. All the wonderful creations that are happening by the glance of Lord Vishnu. That's what is being said here. An atheist may argue that God is no more expert than a watchmaker. But of course, God is greater because he can create machines in duplicate male and female forms. Wow. The male and female forms of different types of machineries go on producing innumerable similar machines without God's further attention. Yes, so like a man and a woman unite, then there's another generation which comes, then they will unite, then another generation comes. So it's happening automatically. You see, there's no, the system is made so perfectly that nobody needs to come and see, oh, maybe this will happen, that will happen, or maybe there's some problem. Okay, there can be health issues, but in general, that's what is said here, that we can duplicate ourselves. Yes, duplicate doesn't mean we produce exact copies, but we can produce offsprings, and that is happening automatically. The male and female forms of different types of machineries go on producing innumerable similar machines without God's further attention. If a man could produce such a set of machines that could produce other machines without his attention, then he could approach the intelligence of God. But that is not possible, for each machine has to be handled individually. So machines may be very good, very efficient, but you always need a supervisor, right, to supervise the machines. Therefore, no one can create as well as God. Another name for God is Asamurdhva, which means that no one is equal to or greater than him. No one is equal or greater, okay. Param Satyam, or the Supreme Truth, is he who has no equal or superior. No equal or superior. This is confirmed in the Shruti mantras. It is said that before the creation of the material universe, there existed the Lord only, who is master of everyone. So before the world was created, he was the only one who was there. Alright, that's the point to be noted. That Lord instructed Brahma in Vedic knowledge. Tene Brahma Hrida Adi Kavaye. Adi Kavi is Brahma, and Hrida means in the heart. Tene Brahma, it's Brahma is spiritual knowledge, and Adi Kavi is Lord Brahma, who is having four heads, who is the creator of this material realm, alright. So the Lord instructed Brahma in Vedic knowledge. Tene Brahma Hrida Adi Kavaye. That Lord has to be obeyed in all respects. Anyone who wants to get rid of the material entanglement must surrender unto him. This is also confirmed in Bhagavad Gita. Sarvadharman parityajya mame kam sharanam braja aham tvam sarva papebhyo mokshayishyami ma suchah. This is the shloka where this is mentioned in the Gita. So this is how you read the scripture. So suppose you find a reference to some verse, then you should try to quote the verse immediately, or you should try to remember that verse, or you should try to go and look in the Gita what's the context of that verse and why the author is linking this verse to that verse. Okay, we just don't read, we just don't go on reading like this. All right, so unless one surrenders unto the lotus feet of the Supreme Lord, it is certain that he will be bewildered. Bewildered means, there's a shloka which says, you know, halava bhaktasya kuto mahat gunan manorathe na sati dhavato bahi, which means that manoratha, the mind is going in the manoratha, chariot of the mind. Today I want this girlfriend, today I want that girlfriend, tomorrow I want $1 million, I want a Gucci bag, I want an iPhone, I want to go to Goa, I want to do this, I want to do that. Oh my god. So unless one surrenders unto the lotus feet of the Supreme Lord, it is certain that he will be bewildered. All right, these are examples of bewilderment. When an intelligent man surrenders unto the lotus feet of Krishna and knows completely that Krishna is the cause of all causes. Stop. Where is it said Krishna is the cause of all causes? In the Brahma Samhita it is said, yes, sarva karana karanam. Is it said in the Brahma Samhita? Hopefully, I guess. Or somewhere else it is said at least. Okay. Sarva karana karanam. When an intelligent man surrenders unto the lotus feet of Krishna and knows completely that Krishna is the cause of all causes, as confirmed in the Bhagavad Gita, then only can such an intelligent man become a Mahatma or a great soul. This is also mentioned in the Gita actually. Alright. Where Krishna says, Mahatmanastu mam partha daivim prakritim ashritam bhajanti ananya manaso gyatva bhutadim avyayam. One who surrenders to my divine spiritual potency is surely a Mahatma. He is a great soul. But such a great soul is rare. Only the Mahatmas can understand the Supreme Lord, can understand that the Supreme Lord is the primeval cause of all creations. He is Param or ultimate truth because all other truths are relative to him. He is omniscient. For him, there is no illusion. Alright. So, which is that verse which says that the Mahatmas are very rare. So, the word omniscient means knowing everything. Yes, that means God knows everything. So, the verse which says Mahatmas are very rare, that's that verse. Na? Samahatma Sudullabha. That verse which says Sudullabha means extremely very, very, very rare. Manushyanam sastreshu kaschid yatati siddhaye. Yes, out of thousands, one try to understand me, and out of that, thousands of, you know, that category, then one of them sincerely endeavors, and out of those thousands, one will reach me. That's what Krishna says. Some Mayavadi scholars argue that Srimad Bhagavatam was not compiled by Sri Vyasadeva. And some of them suggest that this book is a modern creation written by someone named Vopadev. So funny. In order to refute such meaningless arguments, Sridhar Swami points out that there is reference to the Bhagavatam in many of the oldest Puranas. So Mayavadi scholars means one who says that God and the living being, you know, they are same, there's no difference, and God doesn't have a form, his form is illusion. Those are the Mayavadi scholars. So sometimes they say that Vyasadeva did not write this, which is not actually true, where now the author is going to give different references from great acharyas in the past, like for example Sridhar Swami and many other acharyas and many other places. That Srimad Bhagavatam was actually written by Vyasadeva, and it is one of the oldest Puranas. So Sridhar Swami, Sridhar Swami points out that there is reference to the Bhagavatam in many of the oldest Puranas. This first sloka of the Bhagavatam begins with the Gayatri Mantra. There is reference to this in the Matsya Puran, which is the oldest Puran. In that Puran, it is said, with reference to the Gayatri Mantra in the Bhagavatam, that there are many narrations of spiritual instructions beginning with the Gayatri Mantra. And there is the history of Vritrasura. Anyone who makes a gift of This great work on a full moon day attains to the highest perfection of life by returning to Godhead. So if you want to make a donation of this book, then you can make it on a full moon day. There is reference to the Bhagavatam in other Puranas also, where it is clearly stated that this work was finished in 12 cantos, which include 18,000 shlokas. In the Padma Puran also there is a reference to the Bhagavatam in a conversation between Gautam and Maharaj Ambarish. Gautam is Gautam Rishi, I guess. The king was advised therein to read Shrimad Bhagavatam regularly if he desired liberation from material bondage. So what happens if you read the Bhagavatam? You will obtain liberation from material bondage. Alright, that's going to happen with you. That is why we started off with this video. Within the past 500 years, many erudite scholars and acharyas like Jiva Goswami, Sanatan Goswami, Vishwanath Chakravarti and Vallabhacharya and many other distinguished scholars, even after the time of Lord Chaitanya, made elaborate commentaries on the Bhagavatam. These are names of acharyas who has written commentaries. And the serious student would do well to attempt to go through them to better relish the transcendental messages. So basically it's said here that we should also read the commentaries of all these acharyas, okay, if possible, after finishing this translation, of course, I mean this version. Srila Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur specifically deals with the original and pure sex psychology, Adiras, divide of all mundane inebriety. The whole material creation is moving under the principle of sex life. In modern civilization, sex life is the focal point for all activities. Wherever one turns his face, he sees sex life predominant. Therefore, sex life is not unreal. Its reality is experienced in the spiritual world. The material sex life is but a perverted reflection of the original fact. The original fact is in the absolute truth, and thus the absolute truth cannot be impersonal. It is not possible to be impersonal and contain pure sex life. Consequently, the impersonalist philosophers have given indirect impetus to the abominable mundane sex life because they have overstressed the impersonality of the ultimate truth. Consequently, man without information of the actual spiritual form of sex has accepted perverted material sex life as all in all. There is a distinction between sex life in the diseased material condition and spiritual sex life. The Srimad Bhagavatam will gradually elevate the unbiased reader to the highest perfectional stage of transcendence. This is what will happen. It will enable him to transcend the three modes of material activities, fruitive action, speculative philosophy, and worship of functional deities as inculcated in Vedic verses. So basically there's a discussion about sex life here. It's been said here that wherever you turn your face, everywhere you see sex life. So the movies where, you know, they have scenes related to sexuality and adultery and all these things, they are the most popular movies, and they say that half of the internet, almost or more than that, is actually pornography, which is circulating, unfortunately. But when we elevate our consciousness spiritually, then we can achieve the highest level of happiness, which is actually known as Adiras. Adiras, which is said to be pure sex psychology in the spiritual realm, where actually there is no mundane union between the God and the devotee, but there's a very high level of ecstasy which a person gets when he or she is personally in union with God. All right, so that is the original that's the origin of the pleasure of sex which a person gets when he indulges. But when we do not have that spiritual elevation or that spiritual pleasure or happiness, I would say, then we glide down to the mundane sex life, which is considered to be abominable here, unless it is done inside marriage and within regulatory principles. Because Krishna also says in the Gita, Dharma viruddho bhuteshu kamosmi bharatarshabha, which means that I am that sex life which is not contrary to religious principles. So when we elevate our consciousness spiritually, we get a lot of happiness inside because of our elevation spiritually. Because we perceive God more and more, then our sex desire will reduce, and one day it will go away. Of course, that's very difficult. It's easier said than done, but that's the process. That's the process which we ultimately have to do. That's the only hope. Otherwise, Kali Yuga is full of sensual contamination. Wherever we see in the TV, YouTube, Facebook, magazines, everywhere, people are also talking like that sometimes, which agitates our mind sexually. So we should try our best to maintain distance from those people who keep talking such things, alright? And we should refrain from seeing such things in TV or in the internet or in our mobiles. Otherwise, it will degrade our consciousness and we will keep taking birth again and again in this material realm, alright? So the conclusion is that this will gradually elevate the unbiased reader to the highest perfectional stage of transcendence. It will then enable him to transcend the three modes of material activities. Fruitive actions. Fruitive actions means you do something because you desire something back. Fruit. You want the fruit. You plant a tree and you get a mango. So sometimes people ask, oh, I will give donation, but my name should be written on the fan that this fan was donated by Ramesh Shukla or anybody on this day at this time, you know, 3rd November 2001, 5:33 p.m. in Indore, India, this was donated by this person, all right? So that's fruitive mentality. The second one is speculative philosophy. Speculative philosophy means you read something about anything and then you speculate. Oh, maybe this is like this, maybe this is like that. That may not have any scriptural basis because our speculation is simply like the speculation of anybody else. Somebody else may speculate in a different way. We may have our different speculations. So just because it is our speculation generally basically means that you're just thinking of different possibilities. Maybe it's like this, maybe it's like that. But it should have scriptural basis, all right? So, and the third is the worship of the functional deities as inculcated in Vedic verses. So, when we do worship the Archa Vigraha, all right? Archa Vigraha means when we, the idol of God, when we do Prana Pratishtha, which means we invite God, then that idol is not a statue anymore. That becomes a deity, which is non-different from God himself. So, worship of functional deities as inculcated in the Vedic verses. So, we will be able to transcend and we will be able to understand these things more, better and better. Alright. So, there you go. This is what happens when we read the Shrimad Bhagavatam. We will achieve the highest perfectional stage of transcendence. Alright. Thank you very much for your attentive hearing, and if you are new then please subscribe, and if you want a reading then go to my website below. Okay, until next time, God is there with you all the time. Just look to him and you will find him. Bye bye. See you.